Well, folks, hi. I'm recording this video tonight so that we can have at least a kind of compensation for the class you are not going to have this Monday. I have to justify it. I'll be on a TOEFL test, and I'm related to my activities in the university, so the schedule was kind of conflicting. And then this was the way out I found. Okay. So last we were talking about national culture. What is a national culture? How can we define it? Well, as we know, nations are not homogeneous. We have, for example, if you take the case of Brazil, we have many regions, many states, and different cultures inside them. So what makes us feel Brazilians? In every society, and especially taking ours, media is very important for helping in building a national culture. Who brings this homogeneous feature to what we call Brasilidade is in a bigger part the media, the radio, television, nowadays the internet, the big portals in the internet. So the structure of cultural power, we attribute this homogeneity, and in our society it's now represented, as I said, in a bigger part by the media and those who have it, who have its control. Normally, for example, if we take the case of England, we associate Englishness to the BBC. To the English we hear when we are watching the BBC, or to the royal family and their symbols, or for example, what does it mean to be an American? Well, it is sharing a group of symbols, so we are talking about a symbolic dimension of national culture. It's sharing values on democracy, values on freedom, values on what it is represented as being succeeded, the ideology of self-made man, for example. All these ideas help us invest in a national culture. But what can we do with difference then, if media want to make it homogeneous, to bring a homogeneous national culture? What is left for heterogeneity? Well, difference, cultural difference. When we suppress cultural difference, we are able to unify nations composed of different social classes, different ethnic groups, and religious groups. We can take the case of the Soviet Union, for example. They were all fragmented nations. They had different national cultures. And after the 1917 revolution, they started organizing themselves in, around what they called the Soviet Union. Now, what did it mean to be a Russian? To be, for example, a Siberian? And what did it started mean? What did it start meaning being a member, a citizen in the Soviet Union? Now, after 1989-1990, what was the idea of national culture after the fall of the Soviet Union? As we can see, it's a matter of difference and similarity. Or better saying, a matter of differences, and putting this difference at certain circumstances into silence. Cultural identity is a discursive device that represents difference as unity or as identity. We take difference and turn it into similarity. So, taking a concrete case, We are Brazilians, and culturally we are represented as people who has football and samba and carnival as their as its main remarking cultural features. You may not like football, you may not like carnival, but certainly if you go abroad and you see someone wearing a Brazilian shirt of a shirt for the of the football team, you will probably get identified, and you know there is a Brazilian guy to whom you can talk Portuguese. About cultural identity, it helps us then to sue the differences, to unite artificially somehow, it's kind of artificial, unite differences in only one national identity. However, this identity does not subordinate all the other identities particularized, that is, the difference is not eliminated, it's just put into silence. Every identity, not only national identity, presupposes the silencing of difference in order to enable a consensus and the cohesion of a group around its own alterity, the other. Okay, so I am what the other is not. I am a Brazilian because being a Brazilian is not being an Argentinian, not being a North American, not being a Japanese, not being whatever. Well, this idea was not completely accepted by some people who study the matter of identity, and this not this rejection of this enclosing of only one identity for a group led some people, as Judith Butler and Chantal Mouffe, not to take that one would consider a subject of feminism as only one, as constituted. Yeah. There is no subject of a feminism according to them, and we can take by the word feminism all the other identities. Well, in chapter 4, Hall will talk about the effects of globalization over these national identities. Now, we have to think what globalization is. As we have discussed in class, globalization is a movement, a phenomenon, in which the state loses kind of its importance in relation to the capital. And borders are now questionable because capital wants to flow freely all over the planet. Time and space are also questionable, because with the internet, time and space are being considered relative concepts. So if this process crosses national barriers, national borders, it integrates and connects communities and organizations in new combinations of space and time. Space and time are made relative. Hall will show us the effects to the identities inside this setting. All the identities are placed in a symbolic space and time, and in what Said calls imaginary geographies. The space as a sense of place or a sense of your home, and the time by the linkings with a kind of mythic past which is invented. What does it mean, a mythic past that is invented? The stories, and please don't take stories as history, the stories of nation that we learn since our very first years in school. Okay, all this will fundament what we call national identity. According to Hall, Some people who study identity claim that these global processes weaken cultural identities because of infiltration and homogenization of culture. And then we have to think of the book we are going to read next, after David Crystal, the next book, Linguistic Imperialism, because it makes total sense to talk about a linguistic imperialism. And we are clearly talking about English in a world that is using this language as a lingua franca, global lingua franca, to connect these nations. However, at the same time, other people who study identity claim that globalization will broaden the horizons of identities, local identities, regional identities, community identities. According to Hall, there are those who also consider the coming of new identity positions, which means to say hybrid identities that enable what we call shared identities. What are these shared identities? You can, if you are in a social network, you probably have a shared identity in the communities you are part of. When you join, for example, a group in Facebook, you are sharing that identity for that moment of the click in which you join the community. And when you unjoin that community, you leave your identity there to assume another identity. If you are curious about this, you can read Bauman, Community, the book Community by Zygmunt Bauman. So what is this hybrid identities? What are these hybrid identities that Hall talks about? Let's take a concrete case. Although many Anglo-Saxon cultural values come to us, for example, in Brazil, especially in ELT context, we take these values not in the same way that Americans or British or Canadians take them. Okay, but permeated by our own Brazilian identity. For example, if you take the case of Halloween and Thanksgiving in the Brazilian context of English language teaching. If you consider this approach, cultural identity in postmodernity, the tradition, the specific traditions, and all the different identities can be translated. And what does it mean? What do we mean by translating identities? Translation of identities is a concept that describes the how people who are outside their home, their hometown, their land of origin, form their identities based on their local identities and the global identities. So, hybrid identities, they are at least affected by the alterity of other identities. Although let's take the case of a Brazilian who lives outside, although he still or she still considers himself or herself Brazilian, but those cultural values of the global those values of the global identities will certainly permeate what he or she thinks about being a Brazilian. About this, I'd like to play a song for you in which you can see this kind of translation, this need for translation and for dialoguing of several identities in a song. Let me find the song. Just a moment, I know it's not in here, Just a moment, I'll pause. Well, I decided to let the video after the slide. So we were talking about being a Brazilian, and we talked about how outside identities intersect our national identities. So as we can see, the migration from the peripheric to the hegemonic center could be part of a process of counter tendency to homogenization, what means to say resistance. Taking the case of migration, it's just because of it that new ethnic groups, minoritary ethnic groups, are formed inside the state, especially in the Occident, and they take to a situation of pluralization of national cultures and to the questioning of stable truths, of stable national identities. And then we can take the case of the revolts in Europe, especially in France, of the minority groups, the ethnic groups, which are being a target of the attack of new policies against immigration. So as I promised to you, I'll show you the video in which Hausseisches tries to negotiate the identities that form his own personal identity, his musical identity. Right, so as you can see, Raul used of a hegemonic language to try to open the dialogue between two different identities, the identity of a nordestino in the context of Brazil and the identity from the south of the United States. Both have much in common. They are essentially based on agriculture. If you pay attention to the music, to the song, it has a kind of folk rhythm, and he joined two different cultural representations inside one artistical manifestation. Yeah. So, according to Hall, migration can influence in the strength of identities, in making them stronger. These local identities get stronger in the production of new identities. As you enlarge the field of identities, the horizon of identities, you can produce new positions of them, for them. These new identities come grouped in new focuses of identification, not only as apprehension of what they are culturally, ethnically, linguistically, religiously, or physically the same thing, but they get united by the form how the Occidental culture see them as the same thing. And we can take the example, for example, of Brazilians from Nordeste who live in São Paulo or Rio. We are made homogeneous. We know, for example, living in Maranhão and Maranhense culture is not the same thing as a Paraibano culture or Cearense culture, but we are treated as the same. In São Paulo, we are all Baianos, or in Rio, we are all Paraíbas. There is a video of Edmundo, the ex-soccer player, saying he came to a game in Natal, I think, against a team from Pernambuco, and the referee was from Paraíba. Yeah, and then he said, "Oh, we come to play against a team." I'll speak in Portuguese. Ele dizia: "Então a gente vem jogar na Paraíba contra um time da Paraíba, bota um árbitro Paraíba para apitar, só pode dar nisso." So, for example, Brazilians, Mexicans, Colombians, etc., in the United States, they are all Latinos. And then the conditions for fighting together are created. Those groups who suffer from discrimination, from identity discrimination together, they tend to react together. It's what we call hegemony and counter-hegemony. And thus, they will form new ideas of what identity is. Okay? So I hope the matter of national identity is clearly explained, and if you have any question, you can always send me an email. And I'll finish this video right here, and I'll start recording another one, maybe by tomorrow, on English as a Global Language, a book by David Crystal, in which we will discuss the role of English in this process of globalization. Okay, so see you next time.